morning. I'm timing myself 20 minutes here. Good to be with friends, familiar faces. I have to wait for the presentation to come up. Well, just a disclaimer. I am no stranger to trade liberalization. In my former hat as the one of the advisors to the Ministry of Finance for 10 years, I was part of the negotiation team for a number of bilateral trade negotiations that Thailand has entered into, including the US, the EU, BIMSTEC. And I'm not against free trade. I'm for balanced trade liberalization. Let me go to the salient issues. Next page, please, because it's a PDF. Can you? Okay, wonderful. Thank you very much. We are talking about three issues here: human rights, rule of law, and the risk of further trade liberalization in ASEAN. And I have three, in fact, just one main point, which is in bullet three. What we mean by human rights. When we talk about human rights, we talk about substantive issues. We talk about the rights holders, and we talk about the duty bearers. When we talk about rule of law, of course, you are here for 2 days to talk about that, but let me just give you a headline of what I mean by rule of law. I'm focusing on the procedural and institutional issues, the rule-based institutions, complaint and communication process, and dispute mechanisms and standards. The main point of my presentation is this one, that ASEAN, the community, as a duty bearer towards its people, is bound by its legal and political commitment to pursue a rights-based approach in trade negotiation and liberalization. Following this is some kind of salient issues. One, despite increasing protectionism, trade liberalization in Asia still gains strong momentum, illustrated by the negotiation of two global trade pacts, TPP and now RCEP. For ASEAN, trade liberalization through AFTA and now AEC has brought about significant positive progresses and better livelihood of its people. However, it also opened up new forms of risks to the region and its member states. Examples of these risks and negative realities are unequal development or distribution of benefit, environmental and communal impact, and rise of transnational crimes. These impacts have been addressed on an ad hoc, silo, and thematic basis through political and social pillars. They have not been incorporated in the AEC per se, I would argue. Last salient point is the TPP, now called CPTPP, I'll illustrate it further. And RCEP present a turning point of ASEAN. First main point is that ASEAN has divergent approaches on these two pacts. And second, and more importantly, the absence of impact assessment and risk mitigation measures in RCEP will jeopardize ASEAN's sustainability. The main point of my presentation comes from this publication that I contributed to last year. It was launched in September last year. The AEC is tasked to identify global megatrends on trade liberalization in Asia. I'm asked to contribute a chapter, chapter 3. It is called The Humane Aspects of People-Centered, People-Oriented ASEAN Economic Community. Even to come up with the title as a subject of a debate, because I would personally go for something more explicitly human rights. But of course, the team that I've been in discussion with said that to be more palatable, we should not use the term human rights. So it's become the humane aspect rather than human rights. But of course, all that I spoke about in that particular contribution is about human rights and sustainability. This one is shown, this is from ADB, about the impact of trade and welfare. Of course, you know, in the first register, you will see that trade regional integration leads to convergence, to growth. But of course, it can lead to some negative impacts. Unequal net benefits, crisis, instability, vulnerability, the so-called negative impact or negative externalities to trade. you can skip this one. I would focus this ASEAN Charter. This is the legally binding instrument. It is the constitution of ASEAN. We find a number of provisions illustrating our commitment toward human rights, rule of law, and sustainability already. In the first article on purposes, we say that the purpose of ASEAN is to strengthen democracy, enhance good governance, and the rule of law, promote and protect human rights and fundamental freedoms with due regard to the rights and responsibilities of the member states of ASEAN. Also to promote sustainable development so as to ensure protection of the region's environment. In principle also, this is endorsed. But last but not least, ASEAN has a legal personality. Whatever we do in our silo, and we have three main silos, we are representing the community. I'm talking about all the sectoral bodies here. We are doing it on behalf of the ASEAN community, which is the... We don't have the APSC, the AEC, the ASEC. They don't have legal personality. Only ASEAN community has legal personality. We are doing this on behalf of the community, whatever we do in terms of human rights, in terms of trade negotiation. I'm very glad that we have a chair of CEON participating with us. The first time that AICHA, as a human rights body of ASEAN, interacted with CEON was long overdue, but we had it in early 2017 in Bangkok, and we had a discussion about the way forward on how to collaborate with CEON. In that article that I contributed with the ASEC, I pointed out the relevance and direct link between what the AEC has come up in terms of its own blueprints. So in the first column is the Sustainable Development Goals, all the 17. Second column, the relevant human rights. And the third column, of course, is the relevant ASEAN economic blueprints. I understand that we will have a specific session to further analyze the AEC, so I'll dispense with the discussion. Just to tell you that what ASEAN economic community has put up in terms of its own direction, trajectory, or policies, are in line with sustainable development goals and human rights as well. So we're using different vernaculars, but we share the same vision and trajectory. I can skip these pages, you can look up yourself. Now, let's go to the main substantive part that I'd like to focus. This is the structure of TPP, of course it's now changed because of the withdrawal of the United States. It has now 11 members. The final negotiation is in place, but look at the structure of TPP. Will help inform us of the ongoing ASEP process. I like to focus, there are 30 chapters to the TPP. I like to focus on these three. Labor, environment, and development. It is when I was part of the negotiation team for Thailand, we have a discomfort to the fact that why other the trade negotiators had to insist on incorporating some non-trade related issues. Because when we talk about trade, we talk about external activities, sending out goods, sending out services. Why do we need to talk about labor? Why do we need to talk about our own environment? Not least, why do we have to talk about the development of our own country? And these are the points that were discussed in now any trade negotiation these days. Let's focus on some of them, on labor rights. And this comes from the text of the TPP, which is now publicized, it's become public. Labor rights, each party, meaning the 11 of them, shall adopt and maintain the statutes pertaining to ILO. Each party shall adopt and maintain statutes and regulations and practices thereunder governing acceptable conditions of work with respect to minimum wages, hours of work, and occupational safety and health. Non-derogation, this is very interesting. You cannot derogate, you cannot deviate from the commitment. But to say this, as long as it affects trade or investment between parties, this is the linkage between the human rights part to the trade negotiation, as long as it affects the trade between the member states, or in this case, the ratifying parties. If it does not affect trade, you can go along and do whatever you please. On environment, I think I'd like to highlight one of them, which is environmental law has to be maintained. High level of environmental protection continue to improve. This is the CSR part that you need to also promote CSR. This part rather. On development, development is carved out from the dispute settlement mechanism, because it says here, non-application of dispute settlement. Anything arising from development, sustainability, is not disputable. Now, TPP is being absorbed, morphed into another legal commitment, which is called Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership, CPTPP. And I think it is important to say that most of the text will remain intact, but you will exclude some of them. For example, the 50-year copyrights will be reduced to 30. That's just an example. Come back to the core part of my presentation, which is ASEP, the ongoing negotiation. Pictures need to be updated, but this part. In November last year, the leaders, our leaders, reiterated these facts, that ASEP has to be commitment to conclude agreement that realizes spirits and objectives in the guiding principles, the agreed outcomes in the pillars of market access, rules, and cooperation. What ASEP looks like at the moment, and I think the chair knows much better than I do, but I lift this from the statement of leaders. This is the structure of ASEP. I just like to point out the absence of labor, of environment, and of development. But interesting things about ASEP, perhaps, I think is, where is it? You have convergence here somewhere. Of course, you have the economic and technical cooperation. For the first time, within ASEAN, we don't have government procurement provision, but in ASEP, we do have government procurement. So ASEP, to me, is noted by the absence of similar provisions under TPP. I'm not advocating for the adoption of similar, but I'm advocating for something akin to risk mitigation framework within ASEP itself. I think this one is better. TPP is now 11, it's called CPTPP. What about ASEAN? We have 10. These four countries join TPP. They will also join ASEAN. The standards of human rights and rule of law, when it pertains to TPP, bind them. They will be bound by ASEP as well. What about the others? Of course, TPP will affect us somewhere or another. In ASEAN, we recognize the difficulties of having, like my previous speaker already illustrated, the difficulty of ascertaining the dispute settlement. Even in larger contexts, we will have much bigger task of aligning ourselves. How do we align ourselves with these? Oh, sorry, ASEAN Vision here is saying that the leaders said, it's 25, sorry. We underline the complementarity of the 2030 agenda to SDG, building efforts to uplift the standards of living of peoples. I put a thought here that SDGs call for development of national indicators for their implementation. What about the development of regional version by, for the ASEAN community? How can we have the assessment of compatibility and the assessment of gap of current framework and additional measures to mainstream SDGs? We talked about a number of indices. This is the chart showing where we stand in terms of implementation of SDGs. Last year, for the first time, countries voluntarily submit themselves to this evaluation. Out of 157 countries, the ranking at number one is Sweden, ranking last is Central African Republic, falling below 50% line. ASEAN, with the exception of Brunei, which is not indexed, the nine countries there, you see the result yourself, still a challenge for each member state. How can ASEAN help? My point is, when we talk about human rights and rule of law, we are bound, ASEAN community as a whole, as a legal person, including the AEC, is bound by the commitment to realize human rights. I can skip this one. This is just an example of my favorite SDG, the Goal 16 on access to justice. But let me put up this one. This is what the Special Rapporteur on the Right to Food proposed to the Human Rights Council. It has been adopted. This is called Human Rights Impact Assessment. It was adopted in the same year as the United Nations Guiding Principles on Business and Human Rights, or the so-called RAGI Principle. This one is even more relevant to ASEAN, being the state level. It says that we should conduct, before you enter into trade negotiation, you should conduct, as a corporate entity should do, what are the risks? What are the risk mitigation mechanisms that you have in place? I conducted in 2015 the children impact on children from ASEAN economic integration. We found out interestingly that there is a rise, thanks to trade liberalization, of non-communicable diseases like diabetes, the type 2, among CLMV countries. Thanks to the sugary drinks that are imported more easily into these countries. How can we prevent them further? This is just a good example, a very illustrative one. But we still have many people who don't have access to food either in the region. So just to say, and I think my time is up. I have two more minutes, okay, good. Just to remind us that when we talk about human rights, what do we export in terms of trade negotiations? We have two ways. One is in the TPP, each of these four countries, they submit themselves to the commitments under TPP. Under ASEP, we have to collectively come into an agreement. But what we are missing at the moment, and I would like to hear more about the way forward. How, to what extent can we, and I think we are in good time, to actually start talking about the real impact and how we can help prevent. It is not too far off to compare the three pillars of ASEAN. The other two pillars, the APSC and the ASCC, are like safety nets already within ASEAN. When we talk about anti-trafficking in person, especially children and women, when we talk about the consensus on migrant workers, of course, we need to talk, to incorporate, to embed this language into the AEC itself, so that we understand, we talk in the same way, that the principles are truly embedded. I'm happy to respond to any query and answers. Thank you very much.